20 years ago, the Earth shifted on its axis. 20 years ago today, the sports world as we know it changed forever. History was changed forever. And I don't think it's an understatement to say that both our lives and careers were changed forever. Thanks to Drew Bledsoe scrambling in a week two game against the New York Jets.
Here it is, right here. Here it is.
Not getting out of bounds before Mo Lewis could level a devastating hit on him that to this day, Patriots who were in the area remember the sound of that hit.
Yeah.
In comes a quarterback who had thrown, I believe, three passes as a rookie, completed one of them. The sixth-round pick, who in 2000 was the fourth-string quarterback behind Bledsoe, John Freeze, and Michael Bishop. The sixth-round pick, who fell famously to pick 199, and thanks to the late quarterback coach Dick Rabine standing on the table for him, gets picked by the New England Patriots. And he comes into that game, and I'll let you handle the part about what would have happened eventually anyway. I'll let you handle that part.
Yeah.
He comes into that game. Yeah. They lose that game anyway. They start 0-2. They eventually start 1-3, get to 5-5. Belichick sticks with him, controversially at the time, never lose again.
Yeah.
The rest is history. I'd love to know what you wrote that night, if you did write that night, but I know where I was that night. Our guy, Don Squire at the Boston Globe, dispatched me to Mass General that night. And I had been kind of friendly with Brady, as much as you could be friendly with a New England Patriots player at a time when pre-internet and there was less access to Patriots players than there is now, okay? So I was friendly with Brady because I was the young guy. At first, I was the intern in the summer of 2000 and the backup beat writer in 2001. So I was young. He was young. I talked to him because the veterans weren't, Bledsoe wasn't talking to me, the fourth stringer would, right? I remember pulling up to Mass General and I'm walking in or trying to walk in to get the scoop on how bad Bledsoe's injury is. Out walks Tom Brady, a young Tom Brady. And I don't remember exactly how I asked him what was going on. He didn't give me much because, as you know, he couldn't. Little did I know, or most people on the outside knew, that Bledsoe was near death. Because a blood vessel had been sheared and his chest cavity had filled with blood.
Yeah.
But I say all that to say, Michael, it's like, if not for Bledsoe taking off, Bledsoe not getting out of bounds, Mo Lewis not hitting him as hard as he did, you could tell me what would have happened regardless, and you know that, but who knows how the season would have played out if not for one thing being different. And from my perspective, you never know what you're witnessing when you're witnessing it or who you're talking to when you're talking to them, because that moment sent my career as a Patriots beat writer on a different trajectory because they became a dynasty. And of course, we all know how many books you ended up authoring as a result of Mo Lewis leveling Drew Bledsoe. So.
That whole season.
What a career was born today.
That whole season.
The greatest quarterback of all time's career started officially it started draft day 2000. In reality, it started 20 years ago today.
It started September 23rd, 2001. And the thing is, that whole season could have been a what if. Not necessarily a Disney version. Disney would say, this is not realistic. Not only that moment with Mo Lewis, but fast forward, and I'll come back to that moment in a second, but fast forward to a game in Buffalo. You remember this, you probably covered this game. A game in Buffalo where the late David Patton, rest in peace, had taken a hit. He was unconscious on the sideline, and he fumbled. And initially, the play was ruled a fumble, but as they looked at it closer, they said, even though he's unconscious, he's out of bounds. Still Patriots football. They win that game. That was a critical game. They needed to win. Mm. What happens if the ball had been spotted correctly in Pittsburgh after a, I think it was a Josh Miller punt, which allowed Troy Brown to run right up the middle in Pittsburgh in the AFC Championship game. Who knows what would have happened if not for the tuck rule? The tuck rule.
Yeah, I mean, Adam Vinatieri.
Before was the tuck rule. I mean, on and on.
Yeah.
But back to that play, back to that season, that 2001 season. Now, in 2000, as you pointed out, he was a fourth quarterback. He was after Drew Bledsoe, John Freeze, a kid named Michael Bishop.
Michael Bishop.
Training camp superstar, Michael Bishop. And then there was Tom Brady. So imagine an NFL team keeping four quarterbacks. You never hear that. Four quarterbacks, no practice squad back then. It's just he's their fourth quarterback on their roster. Crazy. But he goes, and then in the offseason, they signed Drew Bledsoe, and then they signed Damon Hewitt to big money. So they had big money tied up in their top two quarterbacks. They still didn't see Tom Brady coming after spending the 2000 season with him. He went from fourth
and signed Drew Bledsoe. Hold on. Signed Drew Bledsoe to, at the time, the only $100 million contract in the league, right? Yeah. Yeah.
10 years, $103 million. Signed him to a record contract. So he goes from fourth in the 2000 season. Has a preseason better than any quarterback on the roster, goes from fourth to second. So Damon Hewitt, now the third quarterback, even though he got paid as a backup, he's now the third quarterback. And the coaches tell each other, look, we think our best quarterback is the kid, Tom Brady. He's our best. But we just signed Drew Bledsoe to a $103 million contract. What are we going to do? So
yeah,
Brady actually outplayed Bledsoe in that 2001 preseason, but Bledsoe was the franchise quarterback. That just would have been a major controversy. Eventually, though, Mike, I think that because the team was so bad at the beginning of the 2001 season, as you said, starting off 1-3, and one of those that third loss was with Tom Brady. But the team was so bad that Bledsoe
Miami
was going to be replaced.
They buried eventually the ball. Miami. Yeah. They
he was eventually
going to
be replaced. So yeah, Tom Brady would be there, but who knows how the story would – I mean, he would have taken over, but who knows if the story would have been the same.
Who knows
it's
when?
It's really one of the greatest dramas in sports history. Tells you a lot about life, too. And here's the final thing. You asked me, hey, what did I write that night? I'll tell you what I wrote that night. Nothing. Why? Because that day, September 23rd, 2001, that was the final column – Part one of my career with the Boston Globe. That was the final column of my career with the Boston Globe.
You went to Chicago.
I went to Chicago. I was not in Chicago yet, but that was the final column. That was my goodbye, Boston, that same day, that same morning. Goodbye, Boston.
So you
thank you for everything.
So you weren't at that game
with
me? I'm
going to Chicago.
So you weren't at that game in Foxborough with me?
Was that at that game? No, I watched that game. I didn't go. Hey, man, I was
Here's
going to Chicago.
Thing.
I finally had a Sunday.
Wait,
I finally had a Sunday
off for the
first time in a decade.
Here's the other backdrop of this game. Here's the other thing. If my memory serves, you know, your memory, even though you're 10 years older, your memory is better than mine. Here's the other context of this game. If I'm not mistaken, first game after 9-11. Because 9-11 happened the day after the Bengals game. It opened at Cincinnati.
Correct.
I flew back from Cincinnati to Boston. My dad, whose birthday is today, by the way, my dad, Michael Smith,
Hey,
yep, Mike, the original
birthday.
Michael Smith. Thank you. He called me in the morning of 9/11 to ask if I was okay, if I was alive, because, you know, planes took off from Logan Airport. So he didn't know where I was, but I was in Cincinnati the day before. No games the following weekend, and this was the game, if I'm not mistaken, that Joe Andruzzi ran out with the American flag. This was the first game in Foxborough post 9/11. So there's that.
Correct.
So, again, nothing as we know it might would be the same, probably. You know, if they don't win the Super Bowl that year, you know Belichick was not a popular coach in the media and among the fans. At that point, I think he fell to 5-13 after that Jets game.
5-13 after that loss.
Combined in 2001. Yeah. Let me read you a couple of quotes. I know we're over time. I think you'll love this, though. So I was reading that Jeff Howell story in The Athletic. This is like, you know, it's like, wow, you look back, it's like he was always this guy, you know? He always had it. So this is our guy, Damian Woody. He said, Tom was kind of a jerk in practice, to use another word, jerk in practice, to be honest with you. There were certain things that our defensive coaches wanted the scout team to do. Tom was like, no, I'm not doing that. I'm not creating bad habits for myself trying to service you guys. It was frustrating to a lot of defensive guys because Tom was out there diagnosing, processing, making things happen against our defense. But at the same time, a lot of guys respected him. Romeo Crennel, Rack. On the scout team, he would take what the defense gave him, or he would throw it to an open guy. But we wanted him to throw it where we thought we needed the most work on the coverage. He didn't always give us the work, and he would talk about, well, this guy was open, so that's why I threw it to him. He understood what we were trying to do defensively and where he needed to try to go with the ball. Classic. Classic. Yeah. And here we are, a little more than a week out from him going back to where it all started. 20 years ago, everything changed. Everything changed. The sports history as we know it changed.
It really did. And a postscript to that, another Mo Lewis at Boston story was after that fact. So Mo Lewis never really, he was a good player for the Jets. Really, interesting guy, bright guy. And he kind of resented the fact that his name always came up as, hey, he's the guy who hit Drew Bledsoe and spawned the career of Tom Brady. So it really bothered him. He had a lot of things going on, and it just kept coming back to that hit. Mo Lewis had a son, Chris. And Chris Lewis wound up in Boston, where his father left off. Chris Lewis went to Harvard. He's a Harvard basketball player, Harvard graduate, and he tells great stories about Mo. So Mo, that's not your only story. You got an Ivy Leaguer, Harvard basketball team. You had another Boston story, and it's a lot bigger than your hit on Drew Bledsoe.